Well, ladies and gentlemen, special welcome to AUT Millennium. My name is Mike Stanley. I'm the Chief Executive here. This gentleman to my left is the one you're going to be listening to in a moment, Dr. Grant Schofield. It was his quite revolutionary ideas around nutrition, but I'll come to those in a minute. Some more practical things. The emergency exits are out here in case we need those. There are toilets around to the right as you go out of the entrance. There are more downstairs, many more, so you can avail yourselves of those afterwards if you need to, and of course you'll have your cell phone turned off. Now, apologise for the parking tonight. We've got children athletics out on the track, and we've got swimming in the pool and water polo, and consequently you'll probably walk quite away. But because you're such a highly motivated group, interested in health and well-being and nutrition, I'm sure you won't have resented a lovely walk in the sunshine this evening. You probably have heard of the Millennium Institute, and you may be just sort of scratching your head about what AUT Millennium is. Well, it is the same. One has morphed into the other. Millennium Institute opened in 2002. It was the brainchild of a couple of North Shore-based businessmen, Stephen Tyndall and Graham Avery, the support of others, and they built the original facility. It's since gone on to expand, which was completed last year, and in that expansion we became a joint venture with AUT University, one of New Zealand's most innovative universities. Because the synergy between the two was so strong, Millennium Institute was into high performance sport and community sport and wellness, and AUT University, through Division of Sport and Recreation and in the area of public health, has one of the most powerful divisions in those areas in New Zealand. So as a natural alignment, we also now have High Performance Sport New Zealand based here. So our three main causes, which are more New Zealanders winning on the world stage, the developmental power of community sport, and New Zealanders living longer and healthier lives, combined very nicely with all the capability associated with the research and teaching in a university. So it's a pretty special place, AUT Millennium, and we welcome you for this very, very interesting lecture, which I will introduce now because you haven't come here to listen to me, but I welcome you very, very warmly. Grant's team has covers a cutting edge of high profile research projects, including the Sovereign Wellbeing Index, their MOVE standing office furniture. If you haven't seen that, it's wonderful. I've got one in my office myself, so I spend most of my day actually standing and walking as opposed to sitting and leaning into my computer. I can warmly recommend those. Community design and health, play and free range kids, which is a fantastic concept, getting our kids out there playing with their own initiative rather than on playgrounds that adults have designed for them. And tonight's topic, low carb, high fat nutrition and the associated metabolic research. In other words, you'll see it in the magazine LCHF, I think Grant refers to it as well. They've also recently opened their wellbeing clinic. This offers services in nutrition, weight management and secondary care, mostly cardiac rehabilitation at present, and they're doing some leading work in that area. Now, tonight is about nutrition, and in many ways you are what you eat. Good nutrition is vital to health and well-being, but it really has taken a back seat to cost, to taste, to convenience, and to waistline. And Grant's going to turn all those things on their heads a bit and ask some very, very serious questions about what we should be eating. It's a controversial topic, that fat may not be the enemy in our overwhelming wave to obesity and chronic disease. It might be the carbs. Now for me, I've always tried to avoid those fatty things and gone for the spuds and pasta. When I was a rower, I used to eat thousands of calories of those sorts of things and it didn't cause me any problems. But I'm a bit older now, so I'm listening to Grant very, very carefully in all of this. This lecture has attracted a massive amount of interest. It's full to bursting, and this is the second session, so we've already had a first one, so we're very, very happy with the response. I'd like now to introduce Professor Schofield. He is a professor of public health at AUT University and one of their high-flying researchers. He and his team have been highly successful in publishing their world-class work obtaining over $25 million in research funding over the last decade, a large number of master's and doctoral thesis student completions, and most importantly, challenging the best practice and making a difference to the health and well-being of our community. Grant won't be the only one you see tonight. After his address, Dr. Karen Zinn, New Zealand registered dietitian and a key member, will talk about practical application of the low-carb, high-fat approach, as well as Dr. Mickey Wilden, registered nutritionist, will introduce how a low-carb approach can assist endurance athletes. We will take about 45 to 50 minutes of your time, and then you'll have a chance to have some questions. So enjoy the address, and I'll hand you over to the good hands of Grant Schofield.
Thanks for coming and engaging in what I think is one of the topics of our time, the one we haven't solved, the one around chronic disease. Humans now live the longest we've lived, which is a good thing. We might actually be the last generation to live this long because of some of the problems we have. But it's not length of life, it's quality of life, because almost everyone in this room will likely die of a chronic disease, and the big four are cancer, diabetes, cardiovascular disease, and Alzheimer's and dementia. And it's not only that, you've got to die of something, no one wants to live forever, it's that all of those diseases confer about a decade of disability before death. So living long and dying slowly is where we've got to as a society. We aspire to living long and dropping dead. And I don't say that lightly. And if you'll indulge me for a moment, I will tell you my specific fantasy about dying. I don't know if people do this themselves. Maybe you fantasize about other things. But mine's quite specific. It involves a hill in, the hill on Beach Road going up to Castor Bay. I'm riding along there in my 90s with my longtime friend Stephen. We've just finished a coffee in Milford and talked about our great-grandchildren, how good we once were. And lamented the fact that our kids aren't bringing up our kids like we would have brought their kids like we should they should be. And I think I can sprint this guy, so I sprint him. And just as I get ahead and think I've won the sprint, I keel over stone cold dead. But as I go down, he sees me faltering and thinks I can take this bloke. He too sprints. And just as he gets ahead of me, he falls stone cold dead. So we've both fallen thinking we've come first over the finish line. With a high quality life until the last minute. So it's living long and dropping dead. Now, it may not play out exactly that way. It may be different, but I think that's what we should be aspiring to, is this quality of life rather than this quantity of life, and that's something that we've lost. And we have no real solutions. And that's not true. We know of one country in the world that's managed to reverse obesity. Does anyone know that country? Oh, yeah, so it's all these, it's about the social gradient and the flatness and the fairness of it all in the Northern European utopia. No, it's not that, it's Cuba. It's under Fidel Castro. So here's obesity in Cuba over the last few decades. Here it goes, and then they've come back up again. So the only thing that's worked as a national initiative to solve reduce obesity was only temporary, and it was in Cuba. And it's in what was called the special period. Now, there's nothing too much special about starving under the collapse of communism and the collapse of the Soviet bloc, but that's what's been effective. So there you go, let's go to it. And that's sort of the end of it. That's right, that won't work in public health. We shouldn't do that. So let's examine something else. Look, I've spent the majority of my career on the energy outside of things, on this physical activity and exercise and health, how it affects obesity and chronic disease, especially diabetes. I think what I've been telling people for 20 years was fundamentally flawed in its basic scientific logic, so I've changed my mind and I've started to concentrate more on nutrition. Now, there's a lot of talk about these sausages, actually, probably too much talk, but I'm not about to eat a plate of these sausages, mainly because they're full of a combination of rice, wheat and sawdust, but they're also processed horrible meat, so they were made with a hairdryer by a photographer for PR, so I guess I succeeded there. Karen, Dr. Zinn will show you what we really eat at the end of this, so hang in there, if only for that. Look, I've changed my mind on the basis of evidence, but I don't expect you to believe me. In fact, I hope you don't believe a word I say tonight. And I say that in all seriousness. Please don't believe what I say, but be provoked to do your own research, because the world that I work in, the world of science, has moved beyond the few of eminence understanding and knowing the answer in locked up journals and university libraries. There's now open access through Google and open access journals, the intelligent blogger. You have access to all the information I have to have as well. So make your own mind up. I'll present what I think is a case for what I got wrong with metabolics. Simply stated, I've been talking about you're too fat because you don't move enough and you eat too much, and just change either one of those and it'll all be sorted. And that energy in, energy out, a calorie is a calorie, is fundamentally flawed. The body isn't that simple. If it was, that'd be great. We'd sort it and you could lose some weight and be quite happy. It doesn't work that way. I've been writing about this for a while, so if you want to look at my blog, which is profgrant.com, you can go there. I also wish to say that we've got a reading list from this talk tonight, which is available on our website, and so everything's there for you to go and look at and make your own mind up on. Look, my journey started here. It's actually not a bad place to start a journey, as places go. I've been doing a range of work for the World Health Organization across the South Pacific. This happens to be southern Vanuatu, which is really the best of it. And I've been doing work in diabetes and chronic disease prevention to stop this wave of disease hitting these islands. You know, it's not a bad place to sort of get the idea. There's very little development. There's some locals, there's me, picking up chicks. With the pig, more appropriate. This is a beautiful part of the world, and it's untouched. And it's untouched for virtually one single reason. In World War II, an American pilot arrived in southern Vanuatu called John, and he's now known as John Frum. And that was the emergence of the John Frum cargo cult. So he did nothing that resembled actual work. He called on radios, marched around with rifles and raised flags, which they do today still, on Fridays. And stuff arrived, which seemed like a good idea. So they started doing it as well. So that's how the cargo cult started. But he had a simple religious message, and I think it's quite a good one as far as religion goes. It went something like this. Look, white guys are going to come here. Don't trust them. And so they didn't, and it worked out quite well because there's really very little development in these outer islands. There's some local tourism around the volcanoes. There's virtually no health and safety. You can stand on the edge of a volcano and have lava fly past your shoulder, as I did. But extensively, you've got happy, healthy, fit people, completely free of chronic disease. And when you have a look at their diet, it's, there's fish. The ones in the front are flying fish. That's my most successful fishing expedition. You simply paddle out. Anyone done this? Light your lantern, they fly in, you paddle back in. Brilliant. But it's high in fish, it's high in vegetables, and it's high in saturated fat through coconut. So, incidentally, that's a sea salmon, is that other one there. And when I was getting the little plane out of there, bloke walked on with his fingers under quite a large sea salmon, full sea salmon, and put it in the overhead locker, which I thought was brilliant. And you've got this food supply, as I said, that's, and I'm not the first to notice this, the N. Pryor, a public health physician, went to these islands in the 80s and documented this high saturated fat, low carbohydrate diet, which was what most of humanity has been eating for most of their existence. And it's interesting because you see I've got my WHO manual saying avoid saturated fat. Well, that's the last thing you want to avoid in these islands. And I think the next island tells the story. Actually, you go further north from southern Vanuatu. This is Vila, the capital. And things sort of go to custard from there with chronic disease. Well, not custard, actually. It's 2-minute noodles, rice, sugar, flour, and sweetened drinks as the cheap and main food supplies, and you start to get this real rise of obesity and cancer, diabetes, and so forth there. But the worst of it in the Pacific is this place. This is Tarawa. It's one of the island group called Kiribati, formerly known as the Gilbert and Ellice Islands. This particular island is 40 kilometres long and about 300 metres wide, maybe 200 in narrower parts. It had a population of 2,000 to 3,000 for most of its time it's been populated. It's recently grown to 40,000. It has a history in war. This is the Japanese and Americans pounding each other and everyone else there to death in World War II. There's still some of that wreckage there. Much of that wreckage is now overcome by sea level driven climate change. No, climate change drives the sea level. That's the way around, isn't it? It's no more than a meter above sea level, except for in specific parts where the rubbish goes higher than that. It's a land now free of local food supply. They've sold their fishing rights off. Well, they've polluted the local lagoon, so there's no local fishing there. And offshore, there's a Taiwanese, Japanese, and Chinese fishing mothership. There's three of them, and they process the fish and do that unsustainably. So the money that comes from that buys cheap processed carbohydrates, and you've got this. This is Tuvalu. It's very similar, possibly messier, if that's possible. What you've got here is a wave of chronic disease. So just to illustrate this with the reality of being there, I'm working with the health promoters. There's 10 of them, teaching them how to test for diabetes. That's fasting blood glucose is one way of doing that. Don't eat anything in the morning. Come in without breakfast. We'll test your blood sugars. Every one of the health promotion teams, 10. Five's normal. So that there's 100% undiagnosed, fully rampant diabetes in the health promoting team. Every adult I saw was obese. Interestingly, no kid is obese. Every kid is malnourished in the way that a World Vision type African kid might look. So what's happening? Are parents eating all the food because it's about calories? No. We've got a situation where the adults are what we call metabolically dysregulated, and we'll keep coming back to that term, and I'll explain that further in a moment, and diabetic. And the kids are malnourished because of their inadequate intake of fat and protein. So the hospital does three things there. One, obviously successfully, they deliver children. Two, cut out cancers from chronic disease. Three, cut off feet from diabetes, and they do that for a population of 40,000, between 5 and 20 a month. Just imagine the population of the North Shore, which is five times that, getting five times those amputations from diabetes. You don't leave these places with any optimism, but you leave it with an insight that your WHO manual about eating less, moving more, and cutting down on your saturated fat is fundamentally wrong, because that's not the problem here. It's this rapid escalation in processed carbohydrates, and I think the evidence really backs this now. One of our little malnourished fellows. Back to exercise, just a few other little stories along this journey. For those of you in the sport and endurance athletics world, which I've spent at least part of my life, at one stage I was a professional triathlete. Actually, I wasn't a very good one, and my excuse for that was I was too fat. So interestingly, despite training up to 30 hours a week, I could never lose that final 5, 6, 7 kilos to be in decent race shape. I ate a high carbohydrate diet, one that I was told to by the sports dietitians that I consulted with, and I think I would have been faster. I may not have been any better as a professional triathlete. I actually prefer professional professorism, to be honest. It pays better. And you don't have to train nearly as hard, although you do work quite long hours. The last thing is that I'd been observing, and this is in our lab, where we test for expired oxygen and carbon dioxide and look at how much fat and carbohydrate you're burning, is that we started observing people under these rest and exercise regimes, and we observed that some people just didn't ever burn fat. They were what we call carb burners, and usually expect to burn mainly fat when you're sitting around like you are now, and as you start to exercise more and more intensely, then you'll need to rely more and more on carbohydrate. That's how things should work. But what we were seeing, and I think it really hit me when I got up and watched the Auckland Half Marathon, run past my house, and if you look at the bottom half of that field, it's two-thirds women, and probably two-thirds of those women are overweight or obese. And I think the sad thing for me there is here you've got a group of highly motivated people training and eating as they've been told to lose weight, but failing to succeed. And one of the reasons is, and we'll get to this hormone, insulin, later, this fat storage hormone, this high carbohydrate promotes this hormone insulin and turns off your ability to burn fat. They could exercise all day, they're not going to burn fat. It's only when they can restrict their carbohydrates that starts to go. We'll get into the science of that in just a moment. Let's do a little bit of science about carbohydrate metabolism. I think this is important. It really sets the scene for our complete misunderstanding of how the human body works in public health nutrition over the last 50 years. So you may or may not know that you've got about a teaspoon of glucose dissolved into your entire bloodstream. Too much less than that, you'll die. Too much more than that, you'll die slowly from diabetes. And we very carefully regulate that through this hormone, insulin. So carbohydrates will come in through the diet. Two slices of bread, there's 8 teaspoons of glucose. A cup of rice, the same thing. 8 teaspoons of sugar, something slightly different than glucose, but related. And a can of Coke or a can of fruit juice, same thing. These carbohydrates rush in and they need to be dealt with. The system's designed to work like this. Now, can someone at least go, well done, because this took me bloody ages. And it's just proof that at least you can get good at something if you stay here long enough, which is drawing PowerPoints. So this is a cell wall. Glucose is appearing automatically, I might add. And then insulin appears, that's the little orange bit. And what insulin is doing on the cell wall, it's opening up a little channel. And watch this, folks. That's the best I've got. Glucose flows in. That's exactly how things are supposed to happen. A little insulin opens up your cell wall, this glucose flows into the cells. And we measure that. Often the way to do it is this oral glucose tolerance test. We give people a glucose drink, and we look at how their blood glucose responds. That's a typical healthy response. And also how their insulin responds. That's a healthy response. Neither's too high. Everything's dealt with in an hour or two, maybe less. So that's under normal conditions. Now, humans are particularly primed through our evolutionary history to become what we call insulin resistant. Now, this is a normal response. It's something that's really been useful to us in the past. And why we're so primed is because humans, you may know, have a big brain. It's 1,200 cubic centimetres. It's much bigger than our closest relatives, 300 or 400 cubic centimetres for gorillas and chimpanzees. It chomps through an enormous amount of energy, 2% of your body weight, a quarter of your energy, 16 times more metabolically demanding than working muscle. And it can't down-regulate, it can't just turn off and pretend it's not going, especially when you're awake. So it needs a constant, consistent fuel supply. And humans, one of the reasons, one of the other ways humans differ from our primate cousins is that we're weaker, so we have much less muscle mass than a chimpanzee. Go and have a wrestle with a chimpanzee, see here you go. But we're also much fatter. We retain more adipose tissue, and that is to get through and supply fuel to our brain in the absence of food. So food, unlike today, came and went. So here's what happens when there's no food. You become insulin resistant. It's a temporary thing, doesn't affect your health. Glucose turns up, it can't get into the cell, it goes straight to the brain. So we have this mechanism when we're starving to burn fat in the most of our body, but send any extra glucose to the brain. So that's a good thing. Here's the insulin, there's the glucose response, entirely normal. There's no insulin response because you don't need insulin to get cell glucose into your brain. That's a temporary thing. It mostly doesn't affect modern humans because we're never starving. Here's the other one though. We become insulin resistant in the presence of excessive amounts of food, particularly high carbohydrate foods. Think end of autumn, harvest time, lots of food lying around. What happens now is glucose turns up, but now you need lots of insulin. That's called hyperinsulinemia. It opens up the cell, one goes in there, But insulin also stores glucose as fat, so there's a couple going off over there. So this is a very useful thing for humans. There's lots of food around. You actually turn out to down-regulate your activity. You start to feel lazy. You don't move. The animal models are quite convincing on this as well. They do the same thing. And your off switch no longer works. You keep eating. That's a great idea and a huge adaptation in the presence of lots of food. Eat lots. Dysregulate the off switch. Slow down and conserve energy so you can store the whole lot as fat. This is the sort of metabolic response you get, which is a normal glucose response, but a high amount of insulin. That's great. We call it metabolic dysregulation. It's not just humans we observe this in. A bear going into hibernation gets this metabolic dysregulation, gets fatty everything, fatty liver, fat everywhere. Stores it up, uses it over the winter. Hummingbirds are interesting. They do the same thing. Their hibernation is overnight because of their high metabolic rate. At the end of the day, typical hummingbird, fatty liver, dyslipidemia, all the things we associate with poor metabolic health, but it burns through it and it's overnight sleep, so it's ready to go the next morning. So we see this normal human response being activated in all of us, except for there's no famine. Winter never came. Perpetual oversupply of food. And unfortunately, there's a bit of a shortcut which dysregulates us further. So here's all the known factors, at least the ones I could think of, that also metabolically dysregulate you and put you into this inflammatory, insulin-resistant storage mode. Stress, poor sleep, too much exercise, too little exercise, smoking, environmental toxins, including getting sunburned, not getting enough sun, various diet things, high omega-6 fats, high sugar, high alcohol, sorry folks, a little bit's all right, poor gut bacteria, so when we destroy them with antibiotics, that tends to do damage. Possibly who you are, your genetics, possibly your age, definitely how fat you are, and sadly, insulin itself further deregulates your ability to process insulin. So we've ended up with this, that sort of resembles a modern lifestyle more or less, doesn't it? We've ended up with this lifestyle that really completely dysregulates the system. And then we've tried to solve it by telling people to eat less and move more. Well, frankly, willpower's got nothing to do with it. When you're metabolically well-regulated, you'll be energetic and you'll allocate your energy resources accordingly. When you're dysregulated, insulin-resistant, you will down-regulate your activity and partition your food into fat. End of story. So that's the way it goes. And so asking people to stop being so lazy and just eat less fundamentally misses the point. Humans haven't had an epidemic of laziness. We've always been lazy. That's the whole point. So here's how it works. Carbs come in, produce lots of insulin. That high insulin, and this is a very important part, at least scientifically, until we move on to some more practical parts, that high insulin itself is the direct cause of cancer, diabetes, Alzheimer's and associated neurological disorders, and cardiovascular disease. And this is very important. So this is something we tend to have missed when we talk about high sugar diets and all the other risk factors, that this insulin, hyperinsulinemia, directly causes these diseases. So if we want to make progress on them, we somehow have to get insulin down. Well, how do you get insulin down? Well, I don't know, you could remove all of these risk factors. And that's what we do in public health, is try and remove some of these risk factors, or if not all of them. And that's aspirational, because really you'd have to go to southern Vanuatu, which I know is marginally more appealing than Cuba, but still not a viable public health intervention. I think what's viable at the moment, given the bulk of our population suffer this metabolic dysregulation, is simply to go here and concentrate on food, because removing especially these processed carbohydrates and returning to a higher fat food, less processed food situation, like we've eaten for almost the entire time we've been on the planet, is really the workaround that's feasible, yet we promote exactly the opposite. I'm not the first one to say this, of course, so you might think this is all new, but it's not. So here's one of the most prestigious nutrition journals in 1970, Stock and Yudkin. Yudkin was a great researcher, taken out of the game really by the food industry when he started to publish his work, his most famous being the book Pure, White and Deadly on sugar. But really, at that point, at least in the UK, the predominant way of losing weight was to restrict your dietary carbohydrates, and it was the choice of the majority of British physicians. And then what was followed was a war of research, some fraudulent through Ansel Keys in the US Department of Agriculture, who falsified what became known as the Seven Country Study, where he wrongly claimed that saturated fat was associated with cardiovascular mortality across seven countries, when in fact he had a choice of 23, including New Zealand. He just chose the seven that fit on the line, which for those of you research is known to be a bad idea. My boys are here, they're in year seven, you know that's not right, mate. But we do know now, and the clinical trials, there's probably 20 good clinical trials trying to understand which diets are the best for losing weight initially and keeping it off. I draw your attention to this one. It's a 2-year study called the Israeli Diet Study. They pitted, these are 2 years worth of data. This is weight loss. This is the weight you lose on a calorie-restricted low-fat diet. You do lose weight. You do have a rebound, as in most diets, so you're asked to be hungry here. Here's a low glycemic index, again, calorie-restricted Mediterranean diet, superior. And here's the energy unrestricted, eat as much as you like until you feel full, low carbohydrate, high fat diet, which at least has superior initial weight loss and better than at least the low calorie, low fat in the longer term. It's safe and does better on virtually every cardiometabolic risk factor you can measure. So this is I think we're getting to the point where we now understand these diets are safe. We now understand that they have efficacy. Adherence is still an issue in diets because, frankly, the food environment is still what I would call pathological. It's very hard to go and get whole food, which is plant and healthy animal-based, at the drop of a hat. Go into any service station and see what you can find. Go into the supermarket. I mean, I've been encouraging people to eat food that either rots in 3 days and or your grandmother would recognise it, preferably both. Of the 100,000 odd items in the supermarket, I would say 99% of those don't fall into either of those categories. One thing you can do, I think this is, let me just tell you about this study. I think it's important, came out last year. Don't try and read anything there. But it's one thing to ask people to eat one way and send them on their way. It's another thing to come and have them live in your metabolic ward for 7 months, as I did in this study, and give them exactly what they're supposed to eat. These are incredibly expensive, $300,000 per subject. So you can understand why we don't really get to do this very often. What they did here is that they had these people come in, they ate the same for 4 months and they were obese, they lost between 10 and 15% of their body weight. And then they each received a month in a different order on and these were equal caloric. So they measured their energy output in a metabolic chamber, and they gave them the same amount of calories of a low-fat diet, a low glycemic index Mediterranean diet, and a high-fat, low-carbohydrate diet. And what's fascinating here is that this really does tell the metabolic picture, because the people on the low-carbohydrate, high-fat diet not only keep their weight off longer, but expend more energy. So the whole energy in, energy out is related to what you eat. When you have insulin-provoking diets, you produce less energy out. When you have non-insulin-provoking diets, you produce more energy out. And that's a fundamentally important point, that your whole metabolism changes when you're able to restrict dietary carbohydrates if you're sensitive to them. Okay, so I want to talk about, that's weight, and I think most people understand that these are good weight loss diets, but I think the bit that's untouched is diabetes. It's this epidemic that's on us and is set to cripple us economically. This is a guy, Joseph Kraft, who's a 91-year-old pathologist we're currently working with. still only semi-retired, still works. His work has been in insulin and glucose metabolism. We rang him in Chicago the other day. An old fellow answered the phone. Hello? Like, Dr. Kraft. He's like, oh, yeah, I'll just go and get Dad for you. So we've been talking about diabetes. I'll show you some of Dr. Kraft's work in a moment. And this is, I think, where the problems start with diabetes. Here's a typical diabetes food plate. It's a fantastic diet if you're metabolically well-regulated. High in fruits and vegetables, proteins, some carbohydrates. If you're in good shape, this will suit you. If you're a diabetic, type 2 diabetic, which we'll talk about type 1s in a moment too, then this creates problems because of the carbohydrates in it. And I think we're failing to recognise that in diabetes research. To give you more of a clear view, it's about a quarter of that plate is made up of carbohydrates, starchy carbohydrates in particular. I think that the latest research, and was not the latest research, that's the problem, but the research I'm going to show you really changes how, if you're metabolically dysregulated, diabetic, you would think about things. So here's a typical experiment. This one was done in the 80s. You give people who are of normal metabolic health glucose, they process it. You give people who aren't glucose, they don't process it so well. So you think, well, I'll feed you beans. The study was done in India, so they thought about all sorts of beans, several different varieties, and a lower glycemic index to response to beans for the healthy subjects, and still a reduced one for the diabetics, although starting to resemble sugar for the normal people. But they also measured insulin here, and I think this tells a story. So here's your insulin response to glucose for healthy people. Here's your insulin response to beans for healthy people. That's good. And this is one of the reasons that beans are high carbohydrate but and high fiber work well for metabolically healthy people. But here's the insulin response still going up after a couple of hours for these people. And here's beans, sugar. So it doesn't reduce this insulin response. It's still high. And this is one of the reasons I think dietary carbohydrate restriction for diabetics is so important. Another study in the 80s goes on for 5 hours. Glucose response to glucose, to some beans again, to some starchy carbohydrates right past a potato. And you see that these diabetics have a reduced glycemic response, glucose response to these foods. But the insulin response is another story. Here's the insulin response to glucose. And I'll leave that up there because this is really interesting. Here's the insulin response to beans this time, two types of beans. I'll leave the names up there. We've got rice. There. Potatoes, bread. And last of all, this one sneaking up here. Here's the insulin response to, you guessed it, oatmeal. So what this really shows is how much insulin response we get when you start to become metabolically dysregulated to these healthier high carbohydrate foods, and it doesn't look good. So that's really my reasoning behind why we should start to restrict dietary carbohydrates and promote a higher fat. You've got to eat something, and fat's benign, so let's go for that, and it's satiating, and it can be highly nutritious if it's part of whole food. Let's start eating more of that. It's not our friend, it's not our foe, it's our friend, I think, here. This was published in the late 80s in the most prestigious diabetes journal, Diabetes Care. I would have thought it's important. Since the 80s, it's been cited once. Ouch. So there you go. So the medical and nutrition world has taken virtually no notice, in my mind, of some of the most important results about the foods we've been promoting for 50 years. And I think we can do better than that. And we will. That's why we're here. And you can help me. So what for it? How about just eating some food that looks like what we've eaten for most of the time we've been on the planet? Vegetables, meats, whole actual animals, some seasonal things here and there. It's low in carbohydrates, it's high in fat, and you do well on it. But it's not me telling you to do well on it. We've seen how you lose weight on it. But here's how you do if you're a type 2 diabetic. Here's your insulin response for a diabetic. Here's the same person a year later, basically cured of all symptoms of type 2 diabetes, after taking such a dietary regime. This is Dr. Kraft's work, which we're helping reanalyze as soon as we get some of that through our processes. There's a randomized controlled trial, same thing this year with type 2 diabetics, great outcomes. You put them on this sort of diet, they do better, they stick to it longer, they feel fuller, but most important, their blood glucose and their blood insulin is under control. They lose weight, they feel good, they become regulated again. Here's what you see. This is a single type 1 diabetic. These are the people who don't produce any insulin. They have to, the recommendation is you take about 200 grams of carbohydrates in your diet and you try and inject yourself with insulin or through a pump to match it to that. That's highly problematic if we've got any type 1 diabetics here, because you miss all the time. You see these wild fluctuations in blood glucose, both hyperglycemia, which damages your body, and hypoglycemia, which will send you unconscious when you're driving, which may not end well. Here's the same person a day after going on a lower carbohydrate diet with a higher fat. Their blood glucose is much more controlled. Here's a study looking at someone's longer term blood glucose control. Here they are on their what they're recommended to be, which is high and dangerous. Here's what they get after being on 150 grams of carbohydrate for a day for a few months. And here's when they restrict their carbohydrates to more of what we call a ketogenic diet, which is a very low carbohydrate diet, after a year, which are sensational results and virtually unheard of in our drug-managed diabetes practice these days. Another study following people over 6 years, type 1 diabetics, people who adhere to the advice they're giving in one session and even slightly adhere to it do very well. That's about 50% of people. The other 50% don't listen, which is to be expected. I'm not expecting one session is going to solve the world, but at least with these diabetics, it has profound effects. Cited so far zero times. So that's the impact it's had. Admittedly, it was only last year, so we're waiting for the catch-up, but in my mind, it's time the scientific world, the medical world, and public health took notice of the fact that our dietary recommendations, one size fits all, are wrong and cause the people who are most vulnerable the most harm. I'll do all right on a high carb, low fat diet, sort of, probably won't feel as good, but the people who are most harmed by that diet are the ones who most need to get good dietary advice. I just want to finish with this little part. I think this is probably the most exciting part of these lower carbohydrate diets. If anyone has tried this method, and I assume some people here would have, I think you start with the idea, oh, maybe I'll lose a few kilos, you know, I'll be able to put the lycra back on or something. Is that how people think? Well, I don't know. What happens, of course, is when you first restrict your carbohydrates, you haven't got enough glucose to run your brain. So for 2 days, you turn stupid, and you know, depending on what your job is, either go to work or don't. I came here, still here, and then you reorchestrate the way you send metabolites around your body. You start to rely on these ketones, especially beta hydroxybutyrate. A byproduct of fatty acid oxidation, to run your brain. And that seems to have profound effects upon your energy levels, the stability of your energy levels. Because you now have a constant supply of that from your fat, which has many thousands of calories, even for the leanest of us, you don't end up falling off that glucose cliff every few hours. And I think that's the major benefit of these low-carbohydrate diets, the brain and cognitive health benefits associated with that. So there's evidence to show that it makes you marginally smarter, so your cognition is better through running your brain on ketones. And frankly, we should be thinking about this, because this is the system that humans have run on for the majority of the time they've been on the planet, and we just haven't bothered using the dual fuel system recently. I think you could try it. It works quite well. More importantly, when we start to run our brain on glucose exclusively, we start to observe a real increase in these neurological disorders. So we're talking about a range of things, and they could be from autism to ADHD, but more importantly, is Alzheimer's and dementias and cognitive declines with aging, and also some of these mitochondrial diseases and other neuronal diseases like Parkinson's disease and MS. People, when they cool their brain off by running it on ketones, do very well. And, I think this is really the most exciting area of research for us, along with cancer, which I'll finish with, for dietary intervention, is to understand what this can do for our brain. And this, look, you don't, I've seen it in my family, you're much better off living long, healthy, and dropping dead than getting a chronic disease. But the worst of the chronic diseases, if you've seen them in your family, is when you lose your brain. Because the body works, but the soul's gone. And, you know, it's a frightening way to go, frightening for everyone. Let's just finish with cancer. I think that also offers a great deal of promise. The research isn't there yet. I fully acknowledge that. But for many cancers, we see what's called the Warburg effect, which is that cancer cells are highly metabolically active. They mostly rely on glucose, or some of the main cancers do, breast and prostate in particular. And they don't respond to catabolic and anabolic signaling. They're constantly what we call anabolic, in a growth mode. So when you switch your body into a catabolic restoration mode, which these low carbohydrate diets tend to do, then the cancer cells respond fairly poorly to that. They keep on proliferating, and that's when you can hit them with the chemo, and it'll get them. And there's really some very, very interesting animal research in this area, and we just need to progress that now to human trials. So stay tuned, and that's a good paper to read. It's on my reading list. If you want interested in this neurological stuff, this is a nice summary. It's free. It'll be on the website. So look, in closing, I do think there's evidence to start to think seriously as a society about how we treat these starchy carbohydrates. Sugar's a no-brainer, but we can start on the rest of them as well. They'll work for some people, but will do harm to others. I keep hearing this is controversial, and I acknowledge that the word fat seems to create that. It's unfortunate the word fat and being fat is spelt the same. But when we're talking about eating a diet that really resembles what humans have eaten for the majority of the time on the planet, I can hardly see the controversy in that. It should be controversial while we're supporting something else. Thank you very much. Right, okay, I wasn't actually going. Because it's now my privilege to introduce my colleague, Dr. Karen Zinn, who has a PhD in nutrition and weight loss and public health. She's a New Zealand registered dietitian, and she is the one with the expertise in telling you how to actually eat or this. I'm a hacker, I acknowledge it. I see food, I eat it. I cut bits of cheese and grab nuts out of the cupboard. She'll tell you how to really do it. So welcome, Karen.
I'm going to talk to you this evening about the practical application of this diet. But first, I just want to give you my little journey of how I got here. So up until about November last year, I considered myself to be a mainstream registered dietitian. So the teaching that I would incorporate into my students' work would be mainstream dietary behavior, which is based on food nutrition guidelines, high carbohydrate, moderate protein, low fat for weight loss and for chronic disease. And in my clinic, when people would come and see me, the advice that I would give would be largely based on portion control, reducing calories, reducing fat, because fat's high in calories. And I guess in November last year, our team became exposed to this information, this material. And I guess as a duty as a registered dietitian, I need to have a look at the research. I need to have a look at the evidence to provide a good, optimal service to my clients. And to be frank, the research is incredibly compelling, and Grant has presented some of that this evening. So this was a real problem for me, as you can imagine. It just flipped everything on its head. Low carb, high fat, a regime which I would give the thumbs down a few months beforehand. Here was this evidence, which is very compelling. So very confusing for me as a registered dietitian. So what I decided to do was to, as a skeptic, I decided to dabble in my practice and put people on this diet. Of course, ask them which one they wanted to go on. And after people were on such a regime for a wee while, I could see really, really good results. People claimed that they felt better. People claimed that their cravings had gone away. And they'd also claimed, unprompted, that they weren't addicted to sugar anymore. So for me, according to good, sound research, which we perhaps ignored before, and evidence of good, successful outcomes in practice has steered me in this direction. And for appropriate people, this is the way I tend to practice in my teachings and in my private practice. So, coming into a practical sense. Actually, one more thing. It has occurred to me that actually I was possibly born a few decades too late to help prevent our obesity and diabetes problems. And the reason I say that is because of this. This is a little book called The Practice of Endocrinology, and it's the clinical text. It's the 1951 clinical text for endocrinology. And in it, it has some recommendations for the diet's recommendations for obesity. And this is what it says. Foods to be avoided: bread and everything else made with flour, cereals including breakfast cereals and milk puddings, potatoes and all other white root vegetables, foods containing sugar or sweets. You can eat as much as you like of the following: meat, fish, birds, all green vegetables, eggs, dried or fresh, cheese, fruit, apart from bananas and grapes. So this was 1951, and clearly those guidelines disappeared. And the 2013 Practice of Endocrinology text looks somewhat different to this. And in the interim, the state of our nation in relation to health has changed. We've got fatter and we've got more unhealthy. So that makes me question even more. Right, so what does this look like? It looks a lot like this. We need to embrace vegetables, green vegetables. The idea about such a diet is that it has to be nutrient dense. Okay, nutrient dense, not necessarily calorie dense, but it has to be nutrient dense. And vegetables provide us with a whole host of nutrients. When it comes to greenery, the darker the greens, the greater the profile of nutrients we get. Also, your red and maroon colored lettuces give you a heavier nutrient density load, so those are good to incorporate too. Avocado. In my old life, I might say, you can eat an eighth of an avocado, and in my new life, I might say, you know, eat as much as you want until you feel full. So the idea of this diet is that because the carbohydrate is lower, because the fat is high or higher, the satiety factor is there. And for those who might not know what that means, it's feeling of fullness. So you eat until you feel satisfied. And typically, that looks like breakfast, lunch, and dinner without people scrambling at the next snack they can get their hands on for morning tea, afternoon tea, and possibly after dinner. So more avocado, rich in fats, rich in monounsaturated fats, which are good. Nuts are also on the menu. We do need to exercise a little bit of caution when it comes to nuts. I do think that if you were all sitting here eating nuts, thank you, you'd probably eat your day's worth of calorie in 5 minutes. So it is important to put a little bit of a portion control on eating nuts. So nuts are a great source of fat and a great source of protein. Certain types are also a good source of carbohydrate, so we just need to be a bit of caution there. Salmon, I can't push fatty fish enough. The fattier the better, the greater the supply of omega-3 fatty acids. Now, if our budget doesn't tailor towards fresh salmon every night, there's always a tinned salmon option plus a tinned sardines option. A really excellent option to put into a lunch meal, or if you wanted to have it as a snack during the day. Great source of protein, great source of fat, and great source of nutrients like calcium as well. Eggs are back on the menu. Some years they're off the menu, some years they're on the menu, depending on what you know, the Heart Foundation might say about their relationship with cholesterol. They are on the menu for a reason which I'll talk about in a minute. Olive oil, great source of fat in the diet. Also, the best way to use olive oil is in its raw form, so using it on salads is a great idea. This is the controversial one. This is what made me squirm last November. Coconut milk, coconut cream, coconut oil. I'm embarrassed to say that I've shunned this in the past, and I've told some of my closest friends that I think they are out to lunch. And now I have to apologize. After reading the literature, it has come to my attention that saturated fat is not the culprit. And Grant's alluded to that a little bit already, but I just like to elaborate that on that a little bit more. And in 2010, there was a study that came out in the American Journal of Clinical Nutrition, a very high-impact journal. And it was a meta-analysis. Now, a meta-analysis is a very robust statistical study that looks at trials that have investigated saturated fat and its relationship with heart disease. And it concluded that there is no conclusive evidence that saturated fat causes increased heart disease. A very, very profound outcome in my mind. And now people are, I guess, accepting it, and it's becoming a little bit more mainstream. I do think saturated fat is still a problem in the presence of carbohydrate and sugar. So it's not about saturated fat with sugar, but saturated fat in its natural form in coconuts, a little bit on meat, in dairy products, is absolutely not the problem at all. Cheese is back on the menu. People are very happy when I tell them that. Great source of protein, saturated fat, and also calcium. Butter is back on the menu. Arguments in the household can stop, and now cooking with butter is back on the menu. Now, fruits are very high in sugar and high in carbohydrate, and the thing about fruits is that they do include a whole host of nutrients that are good for you as well, including fiber, including antioxidants and phytochemicals. So we do promote some fruit in the day. We don't want to encourage people to have 8 to 10 pieces of fruit, but 2 to 3 pieces of fruit is absolutely fine. And we like to promote the most nutrient-dense fruits. So here I've got a picture of some berries, and berries are a great example of a fruit that are filled with antioxidants and goodness and cancer-fighting chemicals that in one cup don't provide anywhere near the amount of carbohydrate as you do in some other fruits. So let's have a look at what this might look like on a daily basis. So sample meal plan. What I've done, just to explain here, is I've got two options for breakfast, lunch, and dinner. One's in black and one's in blue. Now the one in black, I've put through my computer analysis, my dietary analysis program, to analyze whether the nutrients are actually adequate for people. A lot of critics say, well, we're missing out on a lot of nutrients. So I thought it might be useful to show exactly what we might be missing out on, if anything. So for breakfast, an example might be a smoothie for people on the run, a cup of frozen berries, half a cup of plain yogurt, put some coconut cream, maybe sprinkle some nuts in there as well, or some peanut butter. So easy, quick option. If you've got a little bit more time, or you're a little bit more organized, an omelet would be a great idea. Now an omelet is not just two eggs beat together, put in the microwave. We need to make it nutrient rich. And how to do that is to add vegetables. So what we've got is things like onions, a handful of baby spinach or kale, nutrient-rich vegetable, tomatoes, mushrooms, celery. Celery is a great ingredient for for omelets, by the way. Maybe sprinkle a bit of cheese in there, maybe put a bit of bacon in there, and cook that with coconut oil. So that would be a good wholesome breakfast to start the day. And I challenge everyone here to try this, maybe tomorrow morning, try something like this tomorrow morning, and assess when you are next hungry. And that might be a late lunch. So lunch might look something like this, 2 or 3 cups of salad. And again, salads are only limited by a lack of imagination. We need to use the amazing supply of vegetables that we've got to make a decent salad. So in it, you can see I've got some leafy greens, some nice dark colored leafy greens, cucumber, capsicum, bit of beetroot, carrot, whatever you want in there. I put a tin of salmon in there for my analysis, half an avocado, some cheese, put 10 almonds in there, put some olives in there, and for a dressing, I've used a couple of tablespoons of olive oil and balsamic vinegar. Another option for those who are less organized would be a leftover meal. And I've got there chicken and vegetable curry on cauliflower rice. And I can see some of you are just looking a little odd. What's cauliflower rice? And cauliflower is an incredibly versatile vegetable. All you need to do is put the raw cauliflower broken up into a blender, blend it up in 3 milliseconds, put it in the pan with some coconut oil, with some salt and pepper, and there you have rice. So you can actually do a rice substitute. So instead of having rice, you are having a vegetable as rice. People are skeptical at first, but it's great. Dinner, the example I've used is a sirloin steak, some blue cheese sauce, some asparagus, a whole host of vegetables in there, cooked in coconut oil or butter, and I've added a glass of red wine for my analysis too. The other option would be a chicken casserole with some vegetables served with a salad and with that glass of red wine too. After dinner, I've thrown in a row of dark chocolate. So I'm going to be adding up the carbohydrate here. Chocolate is very high in sugar, but I just thought I'd add that in to show you what it comes to. I've also included a snack during the day of some chopped avocado, some tomato, and some mozzarella cheese. Or you can put some fruit and some plain yogurt with some crushed nuts or seeds. Fluid, I've accounted for a couple of liters of water. You do need to pick up your fluid intake when you drop your carbohydrate. That's really important. And I've thrown in a couple of coffees there with a quarter of a cup of cream distributed between the two coffees. What does that look like? It looks like this. 74 grams of carbohydrate total. To give you an idea, people might have, you know, around 200 or more grams of carbohydrate per day. Some people who are more active might have 300, 400, 500 grams of carbohydrate a day. So that's quite low. It's not as low as you can go. It's not ketogenic. Ketogenic diet would be under 50. We've got high fat, 193 grams of fat, 139 grams of protein, and energy, just over 2,700 calories. So I've analyzed this for an 83 kilogram male who's reasonably tall, who's 46, and who's moderately to very active. And I wanted to see how it came out in terms of nutrients. So that diet, the black one that I put on the previous few pages, contributes about 63% of total fat to total energy intake. It only contributes 10% of carbohydrate and moderate protein. So it's not high protein. It's low carb, high fat. Protein is kept somewhere where it used to be. Okay, so this slide over here, what I want you to look at on this slide is the red line over there. Okay, now this is a profile of all the vitamins and minerals, or some of the vitamins and minerals you need during the day. And what that line depicts is 100% of what we call the recommended daily intake. We need to all eat more than 100% of the recommended daily intake for the nutrients. And don't worry too much about all the wording on the side. That's all your vitamins and your minerals. But you can see there that it's all over 100%. So there are no nutrients that are missed in that diet that I just showed you. Okay? Interestingly enough, look at the energy intake, it's only at 81%. So if this 46-year-old, 83-kilogram male wanted to drop a little bit of weight, there is potential by just eating to satiety. Then we have just a few more of your fat-soluble vitamins and things depicted as adequate intake. And again, please focus on the red line. You can see that nothing, including fiber, nothing is below 100%. So I'll just repeat that again. On a diet like that, that's low in carbohydrate and high in fat and moderate in protein, there are no nutrients that are missing, including fiber, in such a diet. Okay, so there was definitely far too much talk about the sausages, I agree. So this is what the Schofields really eat, and it looks more like this. Okay, a whole host of vegetables with some, what was that, Grant? Some pork spare ribs.
Yep.
And some water on the table. Lots of vegetables, and yet you guys all look pretty happy, so that's good. Before I hand back to Grant, I'd just like to end with a couple of take-home messages. The first one would be, this kind of diet, which is low in carbohydrate or lower in carbohydrate than what you currently do and higher in fat, is suitable for people who are metabolically dysregulated or overweight. It is suitable for those people. Okay. Number two, for people who are not metabolically dysregulated, you can see that this diet can be suitable for them too. It's nutrient rich and it's health promoting. So people who don't have any problems can be on it too. They don't necessarily need to. They can eat pretty much what they want within reason, but it is a health-promoting, beneficial diet in the long term. Third take-home message is that if you are going to experiment with this, a lot of people think, great, this is a license to eat fat. So they eat more fat and they don't drop their carbs. So they end up with a standard American diet, high fat, high carbs problem. Okay, so if you increase fat, you need to decrease the carbohydrate. And the final take-home message is that we all respond individually. We all respond very differently to different regimes. So if something is working for you, you will know it. So go into it with a healthy amount of skepticism, and you'll soon work out what works for you long term.